Thank you very much. So in this talk, I'm going to discuss the expected impact of COVID-19 vaccination in the European Union. So we will move from the perspective of the individual a little bit more to the perspective of the population. As you see from the outline, we will start from going through what ECDC is currently doing and planning to do in order to assess the impact of vaccination against COVID-19. And then to move and discuss a little bit what are the goals and the strategies of vaccination against COVID-19. This is a discussion that is quite important to have because sometimes in the whole discussion, which can be quite important, but touch upon different aspects, you may lose sight on what is the current objective or the next objective of the vaccination strategy. So it's very important to frame the questions right and also to look what is the right approach. Then we will touch upon a little bit on the prioritization of target groups for vaccination and some reflections on what are the potential optimal vaccination strategies. And finally, I will just briefly go through what are the other activities for monitoring the impact of vaccination against COVID-19 that we are currently doing. In the autumn 2020, the European Commission made a call for more coordinated action in the area of COVID-19 vaccination, and in particular, it asked ECDC and EMA some specific tasks. ECDC was in particular asked to support the member states in setting up their own vaccination strategies through the discussion with the technical advisory groups at the national level, and also to monitor the vaccine deployment plans and the rollout of the vaccines. There was also this request that ECDC and EMA should jointly work on a monitoring framework to estimate vaccination impact, effectiveness, and promptly detect and analyze safety signals. In this presentation, I will look in particular at the estimation of the vaccination impact and also partly touching upon on the effectiveness. So at the moment, there are three lines of work that we are looking on, which is the plans and the strategies that we have been monitoring and we have been summarizing in previous documents that have been published. And then the second line of work is the deployment per se, where, as I said, we are monitoring the rollout of the vaccines. We have a vaccine tracker that was mentioned by one of the previous speakers that is providing live information about the doses that are currently administered in the different member states. And also, we are also performing some stress tests with the member states to check what are the challenges that they're encountering during the rollout in order to see what could be done slightly different or where the issues may be. And then finally, the third line of work where I'm most involved at the moment is the impact estimation, which is basically looking at what could be the impact of the vaccination at the population level, in particular, through mathematical modeling of scenarios, in particular integrated scenarios of vaccination and non-pharmaceutical interventions. It's important to stress that vaccination is one component, probably the major component of our response to COVID-19 at the moment, but it should not be seen separately and in isolation from the other measures that have been successfully implemented so far, and that they cost a lot in terms, of course, of economy in some way, and also at the social and individual level in terms of fatigue. But unfortunately, we are not yet at the point where we can see that we have a vaccination able to remove the necessity of interventions, maybe in the future to lighten some of them. And finally, what we are starting as I speak is the vaccine effectiveness studies in multiple settings, basically using real life data in multiple settings from different member states and start to monitor the vaccine effectiveness on the field. So starting from the goals, which is always to be recommended and suggested, it's fundamental to define them very well, very clearly. These are just four potential examples, but they don't mean to be prescriptive or, you know, the goals that everyone should be looking at. But it is really important to stress the concept that the goals needs to be well-defined, needs to be prioritized, and then the strategy needs to be built around the goals that you have selected. This is very important because in a very dynamic and partly chaotic situation caused by the pandemic, to keep composure and structure with a good strategy. Of course, if the strategy is bad and the goal is not good, you will not get what you want. But if you have a good identification of the goal and a good strategy, then keeping sticking to the plan is really commendable in order to be as efficient and effective as possible. The four goals mentioned here as the protection of vulnerable groups and healthcare system, which can be seen in a way, if we want to see these goals as sequential, as a first step. We know that this crisis caused by COVID-19 started off by unfortunately causing the death of a big number of people in a short period of time, together with overwhelming healthcare capacity and hospital capacity in some settings. So the first step would be to get out of this situation and really, you know, assure that we don't get again into that type of situation. Then the second goal could be the reduction of overall mortality and morbidity from COVID-19 in the whole population, which is, if you want, broadening a little bit the scope of the first goal that I mentioned. A third potential goal is what have been quite extensively discussed also in the media about reopening societies. This is an urgent and important need, but we need to put it in perspective of the previous two goals that I mentioned, because as I said from the beginning, it's important to have a structure and have clear in mind all the steps that need to be done, because if we try to achieve everything in parallel, especially in a situation where the supply of the vaccine is not yet as high as we would like, we may risk to be less effective and less efficient and waste some time. And finally, it's a final goal that is more of a wish at this stage rather than a real achievable goal at the moment, is disease elimination. There are some countries that almost reached disease elimination without vaccination by basically isolating and testing and tracing quite aggressively. In the context of the European continent, this may not be so easy, even in the presence of a very good vaccination coverage, because as we see, we have a virus that mutates, we have the variant, and we also have possible decreased uptake in some of the target groups. So it is, an appealing goal, but maybe it's not so sustainable and it's not so easy to reach, and it may come with a big cost, in particular if the vaccination do not provide a long duration of protection. As I put here in this slide, there are also other factors that can contribute to change the scenario where we are. There are issues related with vaccine supply, issues related with logistics, issues related with the characteristic of the existing vaccines that we discover, as it was mentioned by previous speakers, as vaccines are rolled out, we learn more about their effectiveness against transmission, their effectiveness in some specific risk groups, and against the severe disease and hospitalization. All of these aspects are relevant and may affect which strategy and how we want to reach the goals, including aspects related to safety, of course. And finally, as I said, the mutation, the virus changes and affects the disease characteristics and also the protection from the existing vaccines. So all of this may require a little bit of adaptation and some flexibility in the way we approach our objectives. Again, here, once the goals are set and prioritized, then it's a matter of identifying the right strategy by targeting the groups that we need to target in order to get where we want. But in particular, I would stress it's important that strategies are driven by evidence, by the data, and they keep monitoring this data if they really mirror what we expect to see. And that, as I said, they need also to be partly adaptable to a very dynamic panorama and a changing scenario in case of changes that are unforeseen or quite occurring quite unexpectedly. Then there is the importance of having criteria for prioritization of target groups. Target groups have been identified, of course, already by most or all the member states at this stage, but it's important to consider this as an iterative process where we need, according to our objective and strategy all the time, think again how we want to prioritize and target the different groups for vaccination, including other aspects, as I said, related to variants, characteristic of the vaccine, and uptake in some specific groups. One principle is the individual protection principle, which is probably the main one. So those individuals that are at increased risk of developing severe disease are, of course, the ones that should be looked at first as strong candidates for vaccination, but also the ones that are exposed to the virus due to their societal role or their professional role. They could also be exposed, like some healthcare workers, to high viral load and therefore risk severe disease because of that. Then it's important to consider in a pandemic the societal role of the individuals, the essential workers, the frontline workers, especially in the most acute phases of the pandemic. They need to be protected in order to maintain the society functional and to be able to provide to all the citizens the basic services that are needed. Then there is the issue of the indirect protection. This is something that we consider very important, in particular, if there is a possibility that the vaccine is able to protect against transmission. We are already seeing some positive signs in this direction, but as it was discussed before, this is yet not conclusive evidence. Nevertheless, it is good to know that there is some potential effect also on the surroundings of the vaccinated people, in particular of those that are in contact with vulnerable and fragile individuals, and also those that are in contact with individuals who cannot be vaccinated. And finally, there is another criterion that was raised by WHO in one of its documents, that is reciprocity, and in this case may refer in particular to those workers, for instance, healthcare workers that had to pay a heavy toll during the first waves of the pandemic. And so their prioritization would also be seen as a recognition of their key role and sacrifice on top of the other criteria that I've just mentioned. Now, we published in December a report where we wanted to look at the different strategies and see what would be the impact of addressing and targeting the vaccination to different groups. This is quite, I will try to make it as simple as possible because it is quite a busy slide. But if you look at panel A at the left upper hand corner, you will see that we make a comparison between vaccinating older age groups and vaccinating all adults in the population. And as you see here, by vaccinating people over the age of 60, which is the orange bar, you would theoretically avert up to 90% of the deaths that you would avert by vaccinating all adults. This is a strong argument in favor of vaccinating older age groups that are the ones that are most suffering from hospitalization and deaths due to COVID-19. And as you see here, we quantify that to be very high. However, this was done under the assumption that the vaccine would not have some indirect protection, some effect on transmission. If you just move slightly to the right on the same panel A, you see the same type of graph while assuming some moderate effect on transmission. You see that then the relative importance of vaccinating older adults decreases a little bit, but still stays around 70% of averted death compared to vaccinating all the population, the adult population, which is still a lot. And is again a strong argument to addressing first this group if your objective is to reduce deaths. Then what if we include on top of older adults, younger people with preconditions? What is the marginal benefit? What do we gain on top of it? Well, if you look now at panel C, this is what we call efficiency, because it's basically saying that by giving one single dose of vaccine, how many deaths you would avert compared to giving one dose of vaccine to any adult over the age of 18. as you see here in the blue bar, giving the single dose of vaccine or a set dose of vaccine to a person 80 or 70, it can provide, in terms of efficiency, really the protection, the prevention of as many as 6 or 4 deaths compared to vaccinating someone from the overall population. And it is quite as double as vaccinating and including vaccination of younger people with precondition. Again, this is not saying that vaccinating people, younger people with precondition is not important. It is very important. But here we took the perspective of maximizing the efficiency at the population level when you introduce the vaccination. So this is once again another consideration that goes in favor of an age staggered approach, starting from older individuals and then moving downwards. And then given supply, you can then decide to expand in parallel to risk groups in younger age groups of the population. And this is looking again in similar way, but at the vaccination of healthcare workers. And if you see the panel C, you will see that if a vaccine, as we are seeing, is having an effect on transmission, then the impact of vaccinating healthcare workers at the population level may become very, very efficient, because these people are strong contact with sick individuals or people at risk of getting severe COVID. Therefore, the indirect protection provided by vaccinating healthcare workers would have very many positive externalities also for the people that they are in touch with, so that it will have an important effect at the population level, and therefore it will be quite efficient as well. So how to maximize then the impact of COVID-19 vaccination on society? Well, there is not a single answer. The choice of an optimal strategy depends on the objective, as we said, and I will not dwell into that again. And the prioritization of COVID-19 vaccination should take into account several dimensions and should always need to be contextualized. Also, the optimal strategy depends on the characteristics of the vaccine. As we said, if the vaccine in particular is effective against transmission and therefore confers indirect protection. But if our objective, our initial objective, is to reduce deaths and hospitalization from COVID-19, then the prioritization of those groups at higher risk of severe disease, and as we saw, possibly using an age staggered approach, is probably the most effective and efficient way to reach this objective. So just to conclude on this, the societal benefit is heightened if the vaccines are effective against disease transmission, because it provides indirect protection. And vaccinating of adults age 18 to 59 or 18 to 55, it's not important the cutoff here, it's important the concept, the younger adults, is probably not the most effective and efficient strategy to reduce COVID-19 deaths, especially in a situation where supply is limited. However, consideration could be given to specific groups or settings that may have a disproportionate risk of exposure, or to individuals at high risk of severe disease. One of my final messages here is coming from another document we published in February this year, and was highlighting a very simple but very important concept, that we are not yet at all at the stage where we can lift the non-pharmaceutical intervention. We cannot lift the other measures that are in place, and that they are, of course, something that we are all tired of to some extent. But it is not possible to do that, because the vaccination has not reached yet to cover a good enough proportion, in particular of people at risk of severe disease, but more in general, the population level, so that we can comfortably lift or lighten some of these measures without paying the consequences in terms of deaths and hospitalization. And also, any delay on the vaccination deployment will, of course, delay the time when it will be possible to consider lightening some of these measures. This is just a brief screenshot of the vaccine tracker that I was mentioning. Just to mention the other activities that we are doing, this is about monitoring how the vaccines are being rolled out in the European Union in all the countries, And if you want, you can play with this tool that is rather nice, was made by some of my colleagues, and it's giving you a live idea of where we are with the deployment. And then I will conclude with the upcoming activity, which is the post-marketing authorization vaccine effectiveness and impact studies. We are planning to do quite a number of these studies in different things in order to monitor vaccine effectiveness and also to collaborate with EMA in doing this specific monitoring and activity, which is extremely important, not only for the short run, but also to look into the future, because the virus will continue to mutate. So we will need to make sure that all the settings, all the age groups, their situations are not changing according to what we expect. And of course, it's important to do real world vaccine effectiveness, because as it was mentioned in previous presentation, not everything is can be assessed during trials and at the authorization, the conditional authorization moment. So there are other questions that still need to be defined a little bit better and answered a little bit better with more bigger numbers and more data that may come. With this one, I thank you for your attention. I want to thank also my colleagues that supported throughout these activities. Thank you very much.